Yeah, I mean, so great. So I'm Kornel. I'm from Krakow, Poland. I work for SemiHalf, and I'm also a student at Jagiellonian University. I'm currently pursuing my master's degree. So I'm going to talk about improving security of FreeBSD with various cryptographic-related features such as TPM 2.0, Trusted Platform Manager, and Intel SGX. So the presentation is going to split into four parts: TPM overview, two TPM-related features, measured boot, and Strongswan integration. And then I'm going to end with an overview of SGX. So let's start with the TPM. So what is, for years now, we've been offloading cryptographic operations to like various hardware designed specially for that, whether is it a smart card or HSM. I mean, depends on whether you are enterprise level or consumer grade, I guess. So the HSMs, hardware security modules, they are designed to be a secure storage for digital keys. They usually have their own onboard key generation included with their own RNG. And they have some kind of a protection against physical tampering. Usually they are attached to computers on PCI Express lane, I guess. And yeah, so there's that. So the TPMs. I mean, I kind of want to tell that they are smaller versions of HMMs. They are significantly cheaper. TPMs can be bought for like a couple of bucks, so that's that. And therefore, they can be significantly more popular. They are usually attached to like I2C bus, LPC. I mean, they don't have internet access, so that's great. So yeah, they're cheap. All of the resources are available through API. So yeah, this is the basic idea. You can, let's say, create a RSA key, and that key can be only used to like sign certain things. It can be read directly. So that's like the basic idea behind smart cards and also TPMs. TPMs have their own RNG for safe key generation. The sad part is that the standard specifies that it can be a deterministic RNG. It only has to be seeded at manufacturing time with a value unknown to the manufacturer. So that's that. Again, chip has its price. And it also supposed to, all TPMs have anti-hammering protections, which basically means that if you try to break the passwords in dictionary attacks, then at some point you'll get locked out. And it also is supposed to be built to prevent physical tampering. I mean, I'll talk about it more later, but we see. So another way of implementing TPMs is to, instead of having a discrete chip attached to your motherboard, you can have it implemented in firmware. So obviously, it has to be run in some sort of separation from the rest of the system to make sense. It is much faster than discrete TPMs, which are usually 16 bits based, and it just runs on your main CPU. And it is implemented widely as a part of management engine on Intel's, and there's a version from AMD, but obviously it needs to be supported in your BIOS, but it usually is. It's present on most of the modern PCs. So what are the use cases for TPMs? Well, it can be just used as a smart card for generating digital signatures for your SSH clients. You can put your private keys or generate private keys with your TPM and then use it to log into your SSHs. It can be used for IPSec with Strongswan, which I'm going to talk about later. Two-factoring, GPG, just your normal smart card. So another thing is measured boot, where basically you measure various components of system from early boot to through firmware to OS, and based on those measurements, you can then do remote attestation and things. And also, it is used for BitLocker and Lux. GLI is not supported, unfortunately. And another thing that is kind of unpopular, but I've heard at least one use case, is secure storage of root certificates. So you can put TPMs come with a small NVRAM, usually a couple of kilobytes, and you can put CAs there, so to make sure that their integrity is good, I guess. So what's the what are the authentication methods in TPM? So basically, if you have an object there, you have to like authenticate, because otherwise it wouldn't make much sense. So each object has its own hierarchy. There's a platform hierarchy, owner hierarchy, and the null hierarchy. And basically, each object has its own parent. And you can create a password for each hierarchy. And that's like the basics. Then, yeah, there are just passphrases for each object. And also, you can make fairly complex rules with something called enhanced authentication, authorization with TPM 2.0. So that's like a new thing. It's also fairly recently with the new standard. And different assertions can be combined with end of ors. So what are those assertions? Well, it can be a password, just a passphrase like the previous, thing. It can be like an HMAC, which is essentially a pre-shared key, a secret that is shared with the TPM. It can be a state of the PCRs, which are the platform control registers. These are connected with the measured boot. So basically, a PCR stores a concatenation of hashes. And based on their states, you can allow the access to a certain object or not. So there is also physical presence, but it's fairly complex to use, to implement. And it's not really all that popular. And there are other similar things, such as bot counters. And in each TPM has an internal clock, so we can also use that, I guess. Yeah. So what are the caveats of TPMs? Well, the software support is not all that great. The whole technology is fairly new. And yeah, pretty much very few applications support it. The Strongswan does. There's SSH clients that also do that, but not much else. Oh, so all the script TPMs, pretty much all of them, have different pinout configurations. So I checked three computers at office. All of them had different headers, and none of those headers matched the chip that we've got. So yeah, that was fun. Oh, also, the script chips are terribly slow. So I've measured that generating a signature using RSA 2038 key takes about a tenth of a second. So that's like, I mean, it's a smart card, basically, so you can't expect much, I guess, but you know. Oh, and there is at least one documented attack, physical attack on TPM, where basically a guy used a microscope to like take apart the TPM and listen on its internal communication. So that's great. I recommend you watch his video. There is a video of his presentation from Black Hat 2010. And yeah. Oh, and another thing, when you use a firmware implementation of a TPM, we essentially have to trust whoever wrote that implementation. So there's a question of whether do you trust Intel with their management engine or AMD or whoever your implementation is written by. So what are the states of TPM in FreeBSD? Well, the 1.2 driver is like fairly old, and it's there. So the 2.0 driver was developed in the company I work for. I wrote it in last year, end of last year. It only supports LPC bus. We didn't really have a platform to test it on. So actually, we only tested it with a single TPM chip because we didn't have anything else. So yes, there is that. But I mean, in theory, it should work, the driver, with other chips because it's standardized. But you know, I haven't run it. So yeah. Is that. So let's go to the second part. It's going to be about measured boot, a practical use case of TPM. So what is measured boot? Well, every time you load, let's say, a critical part of your system, that image is hashed, and then it's hashed, it stores in something called a PCR, platform control register. They can only be read or extended. That's like the basic thing, and they all have to be zeroed during reboot. obviously. And the extend operation goes like follows. You take the current value of PCR, you do the incremental hashing by concatenating the hash of the image, and you hash that. So that's very simple, I think. So another problem was that we have a bunch of PCRs. There are usually around 24 per system. And we kind of want to standardize what do we measure in each PCR. And the problem is, who should standardize that? Should it be in UEFI or OS specification? So basically, the specification came from the same organization that made the TPM standard, but it's cross-referenced in UEFI specification. And it just more or less tells you which PCRs store information about which part of the system. As you can see, we measure things like from pretty early boot times. We measure pretty much everything, including UEFI images and drivers. So each time something changes, the entire hash is supposed to change. And the third part about the kernel, it's completely unstandardized. So only the first eight or only the PCRs from 0 to 7 are somehow standardized, but you're still relying on your firmware implementation to follow the standard, so it may vary. So event lock. So we might want to tie the security of system to a certain hash, and it's not really convenient, because if we change the order of things that are loaded, then the hash will obviously change. Also, we might want to load a kernel module that is optional. So if we don't load it, or if we load it, then the hash will also change. So it's not really convenient. Because of that, as a part of UEFI, something called event lock was created. So UEFI creates an event lock for each extend operation. And basically, every entry of that event lock contains a distinct name of image.hashed. It's usually a path to a file or something like that. And PCR number, and its hash, obviously. So the basic idea is that one can later compare the lock entries against a database of trusted values, which is by far more convenient than just relying on a hard-coded hash. And then you can replay the event lock to make sure that it has correct entries against the signed PCRs. So there is something called a quote operation, where basically you take all of the PCRs and you sign it, their values with a private key. So you can just do a standard certificate-based authentication for that. Okay. So currently, FreeBSD can't really extend PCRs on its own. There's no support for that. I mean, the kernel can, the loader can do that. But you can do that from the user space. But I mean, I don't really think that it makes much sense at this point. But however, UEFI measures every binary that is loaded using the load image and start image calls. So at least boot one and loader are measured already. So we have that. And loader could be fairly easily extended to measure like kernel and other parts loaded. I mean, there is a protocol in UEFI, boot services, which can be used for that, and I think that's fairly simple. So now I'm going to talk about remote attestation, which is pretty much the most important part of measured boot. So basically, we want to present the state of our machine to another PC over the network. We want to prove that our machine runs good trusted firmware and OS. So basically, we just send event log together with signed PCR values doing the quote operation. Okay. So yeah, the signature is generated using the quote operation. Every TPM comes with something called endorsement key, which is basically a certificate signed by its manufacturer. So it can be Infineon or whoever made your TPM. And it can be used indirectly to establish trust of the code operation. So now, with the event log and signed PCR values, the remote machine can verify integrity of our firmware and maybe even the OS if that's supported. And it works with Strongswan. And Strongswan, for those of you who don't know, is a IPSec client. It can be used to establish IPSec tunnels. But it only works on Linux because it uses IMA. So yeah, there's that. Oh, and so I've talked about why measured boot is a fine security feature. I'm going to tell you why it doesn't work, really. I mean, it can be patched, but someone found a very serious vulnerability. So when we either go to sleep or hibernate, TPM loses its power. You can't do anything about that. So PCRs are supposed to be preserved in NVRAM. TPM has that ability. I mean, people thought about it, and it was designed. But TPM needs to be informed whether we are going to sleep or to reboot, in which case the PCRs need to be resetted, zeroed. And unfortunately, it has to be informed by the OS. So, you know, you can modify the driver, boot your own OS. PCRs now should have wrong values, right? But then you can just go to sleep and tell the TPM that we are about to reboot. So PCRs are now resetted. You can spoof the current values, and hooray, you just broken measured boot. But it's fixable in firmware, and most of the firmwares should have it fixed already. I mean, the CV is from 2018, so I mean, it might depend. No, yes, you're right. I mean, if you're running an enterprise-grade system, then it should have its firmware updated. But I mean, okay. Okay. What can I say? So I mean, yeah, there is that. So that's it about measured boot. I'm now going to talk about Strongswan. So as I said earlier, Strongswan is a piece of software that can do an IKE, Internet Key Exchange, and basically establish a IPSec tunnels. The authentication can be done either by using a PS key, pre-shared keys, or with your standard certificate, with root of certificates, chain of certificates. So if you are authenticating using the certificate-based method, basically what happens is that you take a message, you sign it with a private key, and then you send it to the other side, I guess. So what we want to do now is that we want to use TPM basically as a smart card. We want to store the private keys, generate them using the TPM, generate the certificate, and authenticate that way. So what it gives us is that even if the computer is compromised, well, the private key should never leak. I mean, someone might use it to sign something, sign some things, but it's significantly better than just the private key being leaked altogether, I guess. So yeah, keys bound with a certificate, that's using IKEA, and the access can be only protected with a passphrase, unfortunately. And that passphrase can only be stored in clear text in configuration, or you can be prompted for it. So that's like kind of unfortunate, but that's everything that Strongswan supports at the moment. So this is like a basic diagram that shows you how it's supposed to work. Maybe it's too basic. But yeah. Strongswan issues a signing request with proper authentication, which just means a passphrase, unfortunately. The TPM does all the signing, and then we get the encrypted digest and send it to the other part to authenticate ourselves. So what do you need to even run this configuration? So obviously you need a TPM driver, TPM 2.0 driver, and it's available in FreeBSD 11.3. And you need something called a TSS, which is basically a user space library that can tag to the TPM. So the entire idea is that the driver doesn't really care about the payload. It just passes bytes from user space to the TPM itself. And the entire construction of commands is done in user space. So I think that's pretty nice. So the TSS. There are two libraries. And one is developed by Intel, other by IBM. So I personally think that the Intel one is like more mature. But both are pretty much in development. So the Intel's is, its port is currently, I mean, I think that it might have been already reviewed and might have landed, but the last time I checked, this was on Fabricator in review. And the other one, it follows POSIX. So I've used it before, the using the Intel's was kind of possible on FreeBSD, and it only needed a one-liner patch, so that was pretty neat. So the caveats of this solution. First of all of the keys are obviously bounded to the TPM that was used to create them. And although there is a mechanism to back up the keys, it's fairly hard to use and undocumented, and it has to be supported by the TSS. So I haven't really used it. Yeah. I mean, I don't think, there might be someone who uses it, actually, but I don't know. So both of the TSSs are in development. I mean, they are usable, but they're pretty much in beta version, I guess like you could say. And unfortunately, as I said earlier, pretty much no applications support it. I mean, there are several exceptions, but overall, TPM 2.0 is a fairly new technology. So, I mean, I don't know, we might wait and it will get better. Oh, and as I said earlier, TPMs are just terribly slow. So, yeah. I mean, if you use elliptic cores, it's a little bit better. I don't remember how much better, but it's still slow compared to just doing everything on your CPU. But I guess that's the price of security. And obviously, if you use a firmware implementation, then, I mean, there might be some overhead, but it's not going to be all that terrible as the discrete version. So I guess that's it for the TPMs. So now I want to talk about SGX, Software Guard Extensions. It's another technology done by Intel. And it's supposed to make your PCs more secure, whatever that means. So yeah, it was developed for Skylake CPUs and newer, I guess. And it introduces new special instructions, because that's what Intel likes to do. And the basic idea is that you can run programs in enclaves. Enclaves are separated from the rest of the systems by hardware and from each other. So what is kind of really neat in this technology is that it supports both interrupts, and therefore it works with the scheduler. So if you compare it with ATF, with ARM's kind of similar thing on ARM, well, that's a big problem there. Because if you are in a secure world, in ATF, on ARM, no interrupts, our interrupts are masked, basically. So SGX. Unfortunately, enclave memory, the entire memory that will be used by enclaves have to be reserved by firmware, and therefore it's not accessible. So you just take a slice of memory and you call it APC, and basically it can only be then used for SGX. So because of that, it has to be supported in firmware, and pretty much not every BIOS supports it. But the memory management, there is swapping, is done in OS drivers. So if you, let's say, reserve 128 megabytes for SGX, and then you start running out of that memory, the OS driver can just swap that page, swap a page, and yeah, to regular memory or even to your disk. So the basic idea is that we do a transparent encryption of every of the entire memory that is used for SGX. That includes both data and code. But it's also susceptible to side channel attacks, since data in CPU cache is not encrypted. probably for performance reasons. And yeah, it's called Foreshadow, the attack. It was proven that you can actually just break SGX, listen to extract data by using, say, channel attacks. So, okay, everything in Enclave, or everything outside of Enclave, is not trusted. That includes kernel and short libraries and just everything. So we cannot really use syscalls because we don't trust the kernel. And yeah, also because of that, everything has to be linked statically. I think that they were supposed to change that in the new release SGX 2.0, but it's not really available yet, at least to my knowledge. So yeah. And because of that, Intel had to provide like their own libc and other libraries that can be used with enclaves. And you just linked everything statically. So this is an image taken from like Intel's white paper, I think. And it's supposed to show why SGX is good, I guess. So basically, it's supposed to significantly reduce the attack surface, where if you have an app running in Enclave, then you either have to somehow hack that app that is in Enclave, or maybe there is something wrong with the hardware. But other than that, it should be safe. But yeah. So another problem is that if you want to run an Enclave, before it can be run in production mode with any security features, it has to be signed. And by default, only Intel-approved enclaves are allowed. So basically, you have to enter into a commercial agreement with Intel and have them bless your certificates so you can run your enclave. So yeah, I mean, the community wasn't really cheerful about that. So the Intel's reasoning behind this is that you can, with SGX, you could make basically an undetectable ransomware, malware, and all of that stuff. Because since enclaves are encrypted, no antivirus can scan them. Oh, and also, a huge part of SGX is remote attestation, which also requires some kind of signatures.
So it's not for protecting the user, it's for protecting manufacturers from their users.
Kind of. I mean, it's basically DRM. Oh, sorry, I should repeat the questions. So yes, so the question was whether is it for protecting the users or the manufacturers from the users. And yeah, it's for DRMs, I think, mostly. I mean, you could make some stuff other than DRMs with it, and I will give some examples, but I mean, even if in Intel's SDK, they've made some examples, programs, and part of them, I think that half of them have DRM in name, so. Yeah. So how do we even launch enclaves? So basically, there is a special launch enclave that is used to launch other enclaves, but obviously it verifies their signatures before they can be launched. And the launch enclave itself is verified by the CPU. Okay. And the way it works is that we have three module registers, special registers, that contain a hash of public key used to sign the launch enclave, which is kind of, I mean, the CPU can verify certificates by its own, which is, I mean, I haven't seen that before. So nobody really liked the idea that you have to rely on Intel to launch enclaves in production mode. So they introduced, I think, about a year ago, something called flexible launch control. Basically, the register attack I talked about earlier, you can use it to build a trust chain that is independent from Intel, which is kind of a basic thing. And the registers I talked about earlier can be just overwritten with a hash of your own public key. But it needs to be supported by both firmware and the CPU, obviously. And I think that, I mean, researching this subject was fairly hard because there's not much information on the internet. But I think that FLC is only supported in Xeon A series. So, you know, there is that. And yeah, availability may vary. So the attestation. So it's kind of a little bit similar as in TPM. And the idea is that we might want to share secrets between enclaves over the internet, maybe even. And we need to establish whether an enclave can be trusted, whether it runs code that it claims to run, and whether it runs on a genuine Intel CPU. So it uses something that resembles certificate training attestation. And obviously, Intel has to issue the CA. I mean, you need to verify whether that enclave runs on an Intel CPU. So it kind of has to be involve Intel, unfortunately. And yeah, the way it works is that CPU has some fuses that are burned on manufacturing time. And the private key is derived from those fuses. You can then request Intel to like create a certificate for that key. And it should kind of prove that this is a good processor manufactured by Intel. And yeah, obviously, it's mostly used for DRMs, unfortunately. So another thing is sealing. So enclaves don't really have any kind of non-volatile storage of their own. I mean, they're just a part of the CPU. And we might want to preserve some secrets in a secure way. And yeah, as I said earlier, we don't really trust anyone. So we also have to verify integrity. So we just use AES GCM to encrypt the secrets and store them on a disk or somewhere externally. And the way it works is similar to attestation. And basically, CPU has a fuse. Intel fills it during manufacturing. And I think that they claim that they don't know the value, the value of that fuse. And the sealing key is supposed to be derived from said fuse and from some of the enclave related measurements so that each key is bound to both the code, the enclave, and a specific CPU. Yeah, so all secrets are bound to a CPU, so which means that if you want to have an enclave and move it from one computer to another, it shouldn't work really, but that's the part of it. Yeah, and the interface for that is fairly simple. You just have SDK, and you just do Intel SGX seal and SGX unseal, and it's like, I mean, the idea is that it does everything for you. So what are the use cases? Well, you can basically do something similar with TPM. You can just offload your cryptographic operations to an enclave. You can also generate private keys. You can seal them and store them on disk and later load them and sign stuff, I guess. And yeah, as I said earlier, you can do remote attestation. And yeah, another thing that Intel advertises is secure computation on remote machines, where basically you have a cloud and you have your own software and you want to protect that software from the rest of the cloud. So that cloud can run an enclave, and they can present you with an enclave, and then you can run that code in an enclave. So, yeah. And yeah, DRM. So Netflix has their own app on Windows that can be used to watch 4K videos, which works with SGX, and there's a thing for Blu-rays. So I talked about DRMs quite a lot. Now I'm going to give like a better use case. So Signal is a communication app that is privacy-oriented. So how do we know who uses Signal? Well, it basically bases on your contact list. The way it works is that it sends hashes of phone numbers on your contact list to a server, and that server then checks if that person is using Signal. But then, I mean, those hashes can be inverted since there is not all that many phone numbers. So the idea is that the server is running in an enclave, then client can verify that that service is running in an enclave before sharing any secrets. So yeah, there's that. It's not DRM at least. And another thing is graphene. So this is a fairly new thing. So it's supposed to be like kind of library OS, and it's supposed to allow you to run any native Linux binary in an enclave. So it has like glibc, it has built-in remote attestation, and it was released like last week, the 1.0 version. To be honest, I haven't really tried it, worked with it. I just found it and thought that it would be nice to present it here. But I mean, yeah, is that. So how about SGX support in FreeBSD? Well, the kernel driver was introduced fairly a couple of years ago. And the SDK has also been ported, but it's like it's missing some features. For example, you can't really debug anything on FreeBSD, at least I couldn't do that. And yeah, other libraries that Intel wrote for SGX, such as their open SSL versions, weren't reported. And I tried to run it on FreeBSD, the open SSL, but I gave up after like a day or two. So yeah, I would like to thank Stormshield. They pretty much paid for the entire thing, the development and research. And do you have any questions? Yeah, go ahead.
Did Intel finally make it a speculation boundary, entering an enclave or leaving it?
I mean, so the question is, did Intel make a speculative boundary? So they claim that all of the side channel attacks are like not really of their concern with SGX. It basically doesn't really protect against anything like that. Yeah, go ahead. Like, could you repeat? No, unfortunately, I don't think so. Ah, sorry, I should repeat the question. I'm forgetting. So the question was, do you know if any work has been done to support GLE in TPM? And the answer is that I don't think so. I don't know. Yeah, go ahead. So the question is, do I know if any people use TPM on Intel's hardware, like with the management engine? No, I haven't checked that. I don't know. Okay, so anything more? Any questions? Okay, so I think that's it. Thank you for listening.